Simon & Schuster Audio presents Golden Hill, a novel of old New York by Francis Spufford, read by Sarah Borges.
He advised me to correct the rebellious principles I'd imbibed among the English, who, for their insolence to their kings, were notorious all over the world. Tobias Smollett, The Adventures of Roderick Random, 1748. Chapter 1. All Hallows, November 1st, 20 George 2nd, 1746. The brig Henrietta, having made Sandy Hook a little before the dinner hour, and having passed the Narrows about 3 o'clock, and then crawling to and fro in a series of tacks infinitesimal enough to rival the calculus across the gray sheet of the harbor of New York, until it seemed to Mr. Smith, dancing from foot to foot upon deck, that the small mound of the city waiting there would hover ahead in the November gloom in perpetuity, never growing closer to the smirk of Greek Zeno, and the day being advanced to dusk by the time Henrietta at last lay anchored off Tygett's Slip, with the veritable gables of the city's veritable houses divided from him only by 100 foot of water, and the dusk, moreover, being as cold and damp and dim as November can afford, as if all the world were a quarto of gray paper dampened by drizzle until in danger of crumbling imminently to pap. All this being true, the master of the brig pressed upon him the virtue of sleeping this one further night aboard, and pursuing his shore business in the morning, he meaning by the offer to signal his esteem, having found Mr. Smith a pleasant companion during the slow weeks of the crossing. But Mr. Smith would not have it. Smith, bowing and smiling, desired nothing but to be rowed to the dock. Smith, indeed, when once he had his shoes flat on the cobbles, took off at such speed, despite the gambling of his land legs, that he far outpaced the sailor dispatched to carry his trunk, and must double back for it, and seizing it, hoisted in stanter on his own shoulder, and gallop on, skidding over fish guts and turnip leaves and cat's entrails, and the other effluvium of the port, asking for directions here, asking again there, so that he appeared most nearly as a type of smiling whirlwind when he shouldered open the door, just as it was about to be bolted for the evening, of the counting house of the firm of Lovell and Company on Golden Hill Street, and laid down his burden while the prentices were lighting the lamps, and the clock on the wall showed 1 minute to 5, and demanded, very civilly, speech that moment with Mr. Lovell himself.
"I'm Lovell,"
said the merchant, rising from his place by the fire, his qualities in brief to meet the needs of a first encounter, 50 years old, a spare body, but a pouched and lumpish face, as if nature had set to work upon the clay with knuckles, shrewd and anxious eyes, brown small clothes, a bob wig yellowed by tobacco smoke.
"Help ye?"
"Good day," said Mr. Smith. "For I am certain it is a good day. Never mind the rain and the wind, and the darkness. You'll forgive the dizziness of the traveller, sir. I have the honour to present a bill drawn upon you by your London correspondents, Messrs. Banyard and Hythe, and request the favour of its swift acceptance."
"Could it not have waited for the morrow?" said Lovell. "Our hours for public business are over. Come back and replenish your purse at 9 o'clock, though, for any amount over £10 sterling, I'll ask you to wait out the week, cash money being scarce."
"Ah," said Mr. Smith. "It is for a greater amount, a far greater, and I am come to you now, hot foot from the cold sea, salt still on me, dirty as a dog fresh from a duck pond, not for payment, but to do you the courtesy of long notice." And he handed across a portfolio, which being open revealed a paper cover clearly sealed in black wax, with a B and an H. Lovell cracked it, his eyebrows already half raised. He read, and they rose further.
"Lord love us," he said. "This is a bill for £1,000.
"Yes, sir," said Mr. Smith. "£1,000 sterling, or, as it says there, £1,738.15, New York money. May I sit down? Lovell ignored him.
Jem, he said, fetch a lantern closer.
The clerk brought one of the fresh-lit candles in its chimney, and Lovell held the page up close to the hot glass, so close that Smith made a start as if to snatch it away, which Lovell reproved with an outthrust arm. But he did not scorch the paper, only tilted it where the flame shone through and showed in paler lines the watermark of a mermaid.
Paper's right, said the clerk.
The hand, too, said Lovell. Benjamin Banyard's own, I'd say.
Yes, said Mr. Smith, though his name was Barnaby Banyard when he sat in his office in Mincing Lane and wrote the bill for me. Come, now, gentlemen, do you think I found this on a street corner? Lovell surveyed him, clothes and hands and visage and speech, such as he had heard of it, and found nothing there that closed the question.
You might have done, he said, for all I know, for I don't know you. What is this thing, and who are you?
What it seems to be, what I seem to be, a paper worth £1,000, and a traveller who owns it.
Or a paper fit to wipe my arse, and a lying rogue. You'll have to do better than that. I've done business with Banyards for 20 years, and settled with them for 20 years, with bills on Kingston for my sugar traffic. Never this. Never paper sent all of a sudden this side the water, asking money paid for the whole season's account, almost without a word, or a warning, or by your leave. I'll ask again, who are you? What's your business?
Well, in general, Mr. Lovell, buying and selling, going up and down in the world, seeing what may turn to advantage, for which my £1,000 may be requisite. But more specifically, Mr. Lovell, the kind I choose not to share, the confidential kind.
You impudent pup, flirting your mangled scripture at me. Speak plain, or your precious paper goes in the fire.
You won't do that, said Smith.
Oh, won't I? You jumped enough a moment gone when I had it nigh the lamp. Speak or it burns.
And your good name with it. Mr. Lovell, this is the plain kernel of the matter. I asked at the exchange for London merchants in good standing, joined to solid traders here, and your name rose up with Banyards as an honourable pair, and they wrote the bill.
They never did before.
They have done now, and assured me you were good for it, which I was glad to hear, for I paid cash down.
Cash down? Repeated Lovell flatly.
He read out,
at 60 days' sight, pay this our second bill to Mr. Richard Smith for value received. You say you paid in coin, then?
I did.
Of your own or of another's? As agent or principal? To settle a score, or to write a new one? To lay out in investments, or to piss away in furbelows and sateen waistcoats?
Just in coin, sir, which spoke for itself eloquently.
You not finding it convenient, no doubt, to move so great a weight of gold across the ocean.
Exactly.
Or else hoping to find a booby on the other side as turn paper to gold for the asking.
I never heard that New Yorkers were so easy to impose on, said Mr. Smith.
So we aren't, sir, said Lovell. So we aren't.
He drummed his fingers.
Especially when one won't take the straight way to clear off the suspicion we may be gulled. You'll excuse my manner. I speak as I find, usually. But I don't know how I find you. I don't know how to take you. And you study to keep me uncertain, which I don't see as a kindness or as a special candid, I must say, in a strip of a boy who comes demanding payment of an awkward-sized fortune on no surety.
On all the ordinary surety of a right bill, protested Smith.
There you go, Lovell said, smiling again. Commerce is trust, sir. Commerce is need and need together, sir.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.